So, yes, you can probably have guessed. Not a lot of people know what libertarian fascism is. You know, I challenge myself to look up each and any movement that can be classified as such, and the list that I have currently is quite diverse, to say the least. So, to give you a short introduction into what libertarian fascism is, well, it's mostly an umbrella term used to define people that are generally against the state or want a minimal one, but they also take inspiration from the aesthetics parts of the fascia, as is the case with one movement, or in more general terms, those people are directly inspired by Benito Mussolini or Adolf Hitler. So in this video, I'll talk separately about each movement that is part of this ideological group, and to make things more interesting, I've made two axes that I classify each one of those, with the first one being self-explanatory of what it means, and the second one will be used to show how much they deviate from orthodox fascism or not.
Liv gardet går in i främmande land som karolismen.
So we're going to start off with one of the most known versions of anarcho-fascism, that is the Nixonian type, since he has a book with the funny name, and in it he talks about his opinions on government masculinism and tribal capitalism. For starters, he isn't really a fan of the gender equality laws of the Swedish government, I mean, who is, giving reasons on why a woman will not act or perform the same as a man in times of war, and why the armed forces of nations should be mainly composed of decentral militias of men. This is where his arguments against the state monopoly on violence come into place, stating that men have a much deeper understanding of what it means and how it should be practiced, and thus they should have full control of this trade and when and how to use it. He gives his own take on politics as well, defining it simply as we versus them, as opposed to the egalitarian principles promoted by modern liberalism. And in this definition, he also highlights Western feminism's problem. Because women cannot go with the friend-enemy distinction that far as to say, for example, that Muslims that come here are invaders, they are only left with bickering the men that they would consider as their own, because they don't want to start a war with another entity that would degrade the concept of we are all in this together. He also compares the feminization of men and the welcoming of migrants as racial suicide, and claims that only a strong elite of men can reverse this disaster by letting conflicts play themselves, that is the promotion of war and aggression between different parties, as well as the implementation of duels for issues between individuals. And to top everything off, Nilsson uses quotes from Hitler and Goering to explain a bit of his anti-authoritarianism, because he talks about how lies that are repeated often become truth in our modern society. Furthermore, one strange thing that I saw other sites claim is the fact that Nilsson was a Christian, even though he had strong pagan undertones in his works. Maybe I'm losing something, but I really don't know what to tell you about that. And before I forget, I need to mention another fun fact, that is Jonas Nilsson is a military advisor for the Azov Battalion, so yeah, anarcho-Azovism is rising. This version of anarcho-fascism is almost as well known as the first one we talked about, and the thought behind it comes from the same root, that is, masculinity. You see, Jack Donovan emphasizes on this idea of male tribalism so much that he wrote three separate books about it, the first one being The Way of Men. In it, he talks about what men were required to do back when we didn't have the luxury of today to just sit around and have someone else defend the perimeter, and the qualities that he extracted from those times are still strength, courage, mastery, and honor. I think that strength is a pretty self-explanatory concept of why Jack Donovan chose it as the first quality of men. Courage refers to using that strength during dangerous situations. Mastery relates to the usefulness of men within the tribe, as well as his own independence and sufficiency. And honor, well, is what each man is fighting for in the context of his tribe by using the qualities I mentioned above. Donovan also emphasizes on the idea that good men and being good at being men are two different things, the first one being tied more with abstract things like morality, religion, and productive behavior within a society, and the latter being, you know, how many of the primordial qualities you have. But because nowadays we really don't have the same tasks as our ancestors had for the 99% of known history, we can't really express this masculinity the same, since we are forbidden for example, to show violence to anyone who might be our enemy because we all live in the same civilization. So, in Jack Donovan's own words, masculinity becomes something simulated, something vicarious, or something very intellectualized. For example, gang aggression is simulated with modern military and police. Gang bonding is done through team sports, and groups of men compete with each other in fields such as economics, politics, and so on. He also compares our paternalistic society with the chimpanzees and how they render tribes, and our current society and what we are headed to. He compares it to bonobos. Chimpanzees focus much more on hunting for resources, or if the food is plenty, there are alliances made. But under stress, they revert back to their patriarchal gangs run by male relatives. Females are more of a supportive role in chimpanzee groups, sometimes being moved from gang to gang and sometimes being fought over by other males. So in-group competition is somewhat important in chimpanzee groups, but what is mostly apparent is the use of violence between groups and the male role of defending their perimeters, attacking other groups and assimilating them into their own if that's the case. The bonobos, on the other hand, are kind of the opposite of the chimps because they eat less luxurious food like the chimpanzees do. They don't really compete for resources like other animals do, and they don't compete for females too. In those groups, sex is more of a social thing where there is both homosexual and heterosexual intercourse. There is no familiar structure as well because the children don't know who their father is. So as you probably noticed already, the accent is put much more on females and by extent the matriarchy, where females are the ones who build strong friendships with another groups and they run things pretty much. So you can probably tell which animal behavior is supposed to be us and which one of those we are heading towards. And to explain this further, Jack Donovan thinks that this crisis of reducing masculinity to a very abstract and intellectualized form will result in a complete breakup of the system, and we return to the decentral gangs competing for resources again. This idea is expanded in his second book, Becoming a Barbarian, in which he talks about how he sees the cosmopolitanism of the current United States of America, or as he calls it, the Empire of Nothing, and why identity is the most important thing a person can have. In this book, he calls America's plan of integrating all the world into one single globalized consumer economy as the alliance between the mother of exile and the mammon. He uses the term the mother of exiles to refer to women whose motherly traits like affection and peace between members of the tribe are being applied to everyone who wants to come into this empire and be treated like weaklings all the time. And the mammon is a reference to the businessman who wants to take everyone's money. They together work to destroy the ancient identities and history, and the counter for this is for men to exploit the system and create their own identity separated from this whole global thing. Or in other words, for creating a we that includes only people that you care about, not some abstract way of thinking like saying that we are in this together. And his last book, A More Complete Beast, delves more into the moralistic aspect of what it means to be a barbarian, because he ties this heavily with Nietzsche's concept of the superhuman. That is, he criticizes the way people work on reaction and resentment most of the time, giving too much attention and power to the enemy they hate so much. Instead, he advocates for everyone to have a noble mentality that is defined by the equation good, noble, mighty, happy, and loved by the gods. So basically, if you know what Nietzsche was about, then this shouldn't be really something new you hear about. And by the way, this version of anarcho-fascism is not called that for the reason you think of. You might expect that Jack Donovan took some inspiration from maybe Mussolini, but in actuality he wasn't a fan at all of totalitarian states, be them fascism, Marxism or something else. Instead, he thinks the fascio represents a symbol of primal masculinity, where sticks represent men coming together to form the battle axe. So yeah, it's just a case of the guy considering the fascio symbol something else than most of the normies today interpret it to be. Keep your rifle by. Singing, oh Lord, this earth. Yeah, the more we are going to go down into the list, the more obscure the people I'll be talking about are gonna be, in case you didn't notice that already. So, Mr. Brown is an alt capitalist who is in direct opposition to the more libertine types of libertarianism, like, for example, the bleeding heart libertarians. He proposes an alliance between fascists and right libertarians, claiming that other lib-right famous people, like, for example, Ludwig von Mises, were also sympathetic of regimes such as fascism or the Pinochet dictatorship, stating that the people running those governments saved the nations from communism, and this alliance would be on the common grounds of the entire right spectrum against the left. He also argues that fascism is more than just what Benito Mussolini came up with, stating that fascism and communism came as responses to the demands of that era, and he believes that communism is inherently authoritarian, while fascism is not. Because he thinks that libertarian fascism is desirable, Talid J. Brown also brings strong criticism to the more progressive aspects of libertarian capitalism, saying that one positive aspect of fascism is a strong sense of duty and responsibility for creating a better society, and that people in a libertarian society should not only steal freedom as the only principle, but more and traditional values too, and that everyone that doesn't participate in the construction of a desirable society should, well, get the Hobbesian treatment. The CNT 1611 is a movement that mainly revolves around Spain and Latin America, and it takes inspiration from a lot of other political ideologies that include, of course, anarchism and fascism. They are influenced by a mixture of Limonovist national Bolshevism, Eurasianism, futurism, fascism, especially the earlier times with Gabriel D'Annunzio, Ernst Jünger's egoism, and Spanish anarcho-syndicalism, because that's where the name CNT 1611 comes from. And some of them can even go as far as to be associated with the siege movement and the order of the nine angles. What I can also add to this introduction is their somewhat unique symbolism, which can sometimes be a mixture of all things I mentioned above. But the most important emblem that those people wear is the number 1611, which stands for the destruction of the current liberal system and the chaos that is bound to come afterwards. There is also this eye thing that contains the Big Dipper and represents the North Star, along with the funny rat that actually has his roots in fascism, because from what I've heard, the French fascists were once called rats, and this is how the mascot came to be. The CNT 1611 movement sees anarcho-fascism as a bridge between the extremes of the left and the right. Tempestism, the heart of their movement, is an eternal commitment to conflict, with the goal of an unending war against self, society, and the entire system. The movement believes in a nation made up of organic and natural communities rather than the artificial boundaries set by the state. The identity is bound by culture and shared values, where the nation is seen as the extension of the people. Fascism is seen as a step of anarchism, and their goal is to go back to anarchism from fascism. They aim to create a Hispanic superior counterpart to European fascism by merging Iberian anarcho-syndicalism with the national spirit. Also, as they explain in another chapter, every individual should be a leader, dictating their own terms of life, of course, this being a direct inspiration from more individualist and illegalist thinkers. They admire leaders who rise to authority organically, like, for example, Durruti or Nestor Makhno, rather than those bestowed with power by law. Disregarding any particular economic theory, they advocate for organized banditry and pirate autarky as a means to fight the parasitic capitalist system. And this is done by encouraging global looting and territory invasion, with the ultimate goal being territory dominance, disregarding any concept of borders. Furthermore, they believe in each worker owning their means of production, thus leading to autonomy without monopolization, and their economic stances can vary widely, and they can integrate extreme measures such as systematic cannibalism and a spiritual economy based on Santeria and shamanism. So yeah, if you believe that this movement is cursed, well, don't worry, there will be others down the line that will take the number one spot. Just wait for a little bit more. So for this one, I want you to imagine the worst nightmare of a modern anarcho-communist, because that's what Alexei was for the most part. You know, esoteric Nazi anarcho-communism are not words that I believed I would say in the same sentence, but oh well. So Dobrovolsky, was an influential person in the Russian neo-pagan movement, so influential in fact that the thing you associate with the color red was defined by him specifically to reflect the swastika. In his articles, you'll see him talking about various topics, most of which revolve around his admiration for past anarchists and justifying it as the pagan golden age, only to go down 10 pages and see him being violently anti-Semitic and defending the Maastrichtmann too. He calls his ideology Russian National Socialism in his quest to ally with nationalists, communists and anarchists to make a single force. And yes, when he says that it is National Socialism, he means it, because he thinks that Hitler didn't start World War II and the Jews were behind everything and somehow forced the Nazis into a brother war with the Soviets, and the same happened in the World War I. Of course. Furthermore, he seems to have had a mixed opinion on the USSR as a whole, on one hand criticizing it as a statist capitalist project that of course had a small head tribe influence, but at the same time he thinks that the fall of the USSR was caused by America, that the economy was truly working, so it was causing the USSR to win in the end. So yeah, Dobrovolsky is the least schizophrenic Russian, but I'm gonna give him some credit because he pretty much praised all the anarchist thinkers of the past, and his version of Nazism was pretty much just nationalistic anarcho-communism, although you can see he can be pretty wacky at times. There's also a strong anti-Christian sentiment in his work, associating the modern Russian clergy with the rampant corruption happening in Russia right now, stating that Christianity brought the concepts of religious authority and even colonialism, and he almost makes no distinction between Jews and Christians, just often referring to them both as Judeo-Christians. Of course, his criticism of Christianity goes further than just Jews or persecution, because he attacks the religious tenets as a whole. He calls the monotheistic transcendental God of the Abrahamites as a nightmarish fiction, because there's too much emphasis placed on the supernatural and divine heaven and not on Mother Earth. You see, Alexei thinks that the modern understanding of paganism is flawed because most of the records that we have right now about the ancient religion comes from the Christians, you know, the antagonists of this whole religious battle. And because of that, we think too much of paganism as just a stepping stone to the one true God, as Alexei calls it. Instead, he argues that we should look at folklore as a guiding hand, since that's where all the world of fairy tales, conspiracies, spells, nicknames and riddles reside, as well as to look at nature as forces, essences that influence us in our everyday life, and that's with which we can interact with, or at least show our gratitude to. And what I find very interesting in his works is the fact that he's not really a fan of the anthropomorphism that is present in late pagan cultures, instead preferring the primordial relationship that we had with the forces of nature, as I mentioned earlier. So yeah, this time we'll move to the anime land of Japan and the not-so-anime movement of Koichi Toyama, a self-proclaimed anarcho-fascist group called Our Solidarity. And if you go to their website, you realize pretty soon what those guys are about. Firstly, in the top article listed there, Koichi Toyama defines what he means by fascism, explaining that fascism agrees with Marx on the societal views and why communism is inevitable, but they are determined to stop it, stating that the end of history of Marx will lead to the death of the people, and falling from authenticity. For example, Koichi Toyama states that communists deny political literature and literary politics, while fascists do not. She also claims that fascists save the masses, stating that the groups of fascists are nationless warriors bound by the need of power, and they use nationalism to pretty much fool the masses with bread and circuses. Koichi Toyama thinks that anarchism is the closest political thought to fascism, since he even made an entire political compass to prove his theories. So you can see from the compass itself, there is a general axis from the left and right, but it's accompanied by a vertical line that states how much an ideology is defined by spiritualism and materialism. So in order to not degenerate further into the totalitarian materialist 1984 regime, Toyama proposes an alliance between the two groups above the horizontal line, because, well, I mentioned earlier that he thinks fascism is just a better version of anarchism, since it resolves the quote-unquote organizational issues that anarchists have, and there's also his argumentation that freedom can only be achieved through power. A Remember when I told you that we're gonna have more cursed movements in here than CNT1611? Well, yeah, this is the moment that you've been waiting for. So, the Libertarian Nazi Green Party was a movement that is very direct in the name, but also supported the blending of three main ideas, that is personal freedom, environmental amelioration, and collective action. Of course, there is a significant inspiration from the original Nazi Party, since the symbolism is just a Nazi swastika but painted green instead of red. However, according to them, the movement is more of a postmodern reinterpretation of the historical NSDAP, aspiring to resurrect a more traditional societal form and governance while maintaining the progressive outlook towards human quality and cultural and scientific advancements. That's right, the Libertarian Nazi Green Party distances itself from white nationalism and racial supremacy, claiming that Nazism is a universal ideology that can be applied for other races, ethnicities, and tribes. The Libertarian Nazi Green Party neither possesses an official membership program, nor does it have actual members like, for example, more conventional parties like the Libertarian one or the Green one. It believes in making change at base levels through predominantly apolitical means, advocating that transformations can be realized in the basic societal field without necessarily attaining office or power. The primary purpose of this activism is to enlighten the masses about nationalism, national socialism, traditionalism, and related concepts, with its website serving predominantly as a study of national socialism, tradition, and culture. And now this is the part where I will talk about the Red Lake High School massacre, because it was done by a guy who used to frequent their website. And the Libertarian Nazi Green Party's response was that such incidents were predictable outcomes when thoughtful individuals are thrust into a unthinking, irrational modern society. So they pretty much went full Julius Evola on a fucking school shooting. Fucking amazing. So the Autonomous Nationalists is a group comprised of fake comradeships of neo-Nazis who adapt the visual appearance and action forms of left-wing autonomous movements since around 2002. The concept of free comradeships was created in response to multiple bannings of right-wing groups in Germany, so this is a way for those people to evade the government, pretty much. You see, in order to modernize and break away from this old classic skinhead neo-Nazi look, the AN seeks to infiltrate youth cultures and subvert them for their own purposes, regardless of musical taste or fashion sense. So they intentionally appropriate and transform the clothing style of left autonomies, such as black looks, buttons, patches, symbols, slogans, etc. Although they have a different aesthetic from what you would expect from a Nazi, they still retain a commitment to National Socialist ideology, espousing racism, anti-Semitism, and nationalism. Their ideological references sometimes go back to the left-wing faction of the Nazi Party, represented by figures such as, you know, Otto and Gregor Strasser. And what's funny is that there is one subgroup of the movement called National Socialists for Israel that extends ethno-pluralistic concepts to, you know, Zionism, affirming that, you know, the Jews have an existential right to Israel, but they should pretty much all move there and leave Germany alone. So yeah, in general, they are just some Nazis with Strasser's influences who LARP as Antifa in order to evade the authorities. They can be considered fake and fascists because there is nothing libertarian about them, and the same can be said about Koichi Toyama's group. So this entry refers to the party that is run by Norman Lowell, a Maltan pan-European libertarian. In his book Imperium Europa, which is titled the same as his party, he begins by explaining that the aristocratic democracy that we're currently living in is a flawed system because we allow everyone to vote so that nothing gets done in the long run, because he gives, for example, Italy that had 55 governments in 55 years. So instead he prefers democracy by aristocracy, that is only an educated elite should be allowed to vote. There's also strong condemnation from the vote that decided Malta to not join the UK, stating that it was Malta's chance of becoming one with its European brothers. Because the Anormal Lowell believes that the Mediterranean race doesn't exist, and by clinging to this false concept, Malta was pretty much shattered. For him, there exist only two distinct races. The Europeans, which are, you know, the Germans, English people, Finnish, Portuguese, Spanish, Italians, Greeks, Balkans, Slavs, I mean, you get the idea. And there are the Semites, which are pretty much Arabs. He came to this conclusion regarding the races because he argues that we have a long history of, you know, mixing together, so we are genetically similar. Also, he's strongly opposed to the idea of the European race of mixing with others, especially the Semites I mentioned earlier, like the Sub-Saharan Negrids. Furthermore, Norman Lowell is strongly opposed against monotheism, especially Christianity, since he sees it as a religion of the weak that isn't tied to blood, and calls it anti-life and anti-noble. Instead, he proposes the creation of a new deistic religion that is a blending of mysticism and science. In order to defend what he calls the sacred blood, which is pretty much all the esoteric edits that you see on YouTube. Apart from the stance on races and religion, there is a strong communist condemnation in his writings, as well as an embracement of anti-collectivism and green libertarianism, since he makes those points very clear in the lines of his book. And despite the claims that Norman Lowell is a neo-Nazi, he pretty much denies any affiliation to neo-Nazism or neo-fascism because of his strong libertarian principles. However, he also called Hitler a great man, the Holocaust a hoax, talks about SS rituals in his book, and he claimed that World War II was nothing more than a war between masonries. Okay, now that we talked about all the major libertarian fascist movements out there, I'll include two musicians that I think quite fit the list. Statuie perfa cu care ești obligat să te însori și o să-ți recunoască valoarea după ce mori. Poți să urăști o lume întreagă până la noi. Okay, so now we're gonna talk about a rapper from here, quite infamous for his, let's call it, right-wing messages in his albums. He's pretty much the precursor to modern Romanian right-wing rapping, and he has influenced a lot of modern rappers, some of which might watch the video right now. And the question that probably a lot of you are asking right now is, what makes him so special that I included him in this list? Well, he has a lot of anti-statist lyrics in pretty much all the old and new songs he releases. Like, there is one title of his that can be translated as "The state is the whore that you are forced to marry." And the picture that is shown there is Alexandru Vișinescu, a Romanian communist torturer and the boss of the Râmnicu Sărat penitentiary, shooting Ion Antonescu, the head of the pro-Hitlerist government in World War II. I mean, you can't get more enfeshed than that, honestly. The lyrics of the songs are quite on point, as you can probably tell already. For example, there are two verses that go like this: pay attention, the state is a fellow's parent, the reptile with warm blood, with God ahead to pick up cupcakes and rob graves, and there's also this: we build up fortunes on electronic lights, we receive orders and advice from comical characters, it's a closed circle, a dream meant to despair us, when money talks, the truth is silenced. Of course, there are other songs that further highlight his anti-state stance. Some honorable mentions include "If the State Was Led by Homosexual, Would You Screw Yourself?" and "This is the country of Dick, the Romanian is a slave of the state." Yeah, as you can see, those are truly uplifting lyrics. Ah yes, the funny right-wing anarchist man. For those who don't know, Peste Noire is a black metal band that has themes in their songs related to medieval and contemporary France, as well as violence, folly, disease and Indo-European Satanism. The worship of Satans or Indo-European devils was inspired by the Greek deity Pan, because the band is opposed to the Jewish monotheistic worship of the Semitic Satan that is depicted in the Bible. The reason that I'm including them here is because of the creator of the band, Femin, who took direct inspiration from what he calls right-wing anarchism, although he denies any claim that he is a national anarchist. In his 2021 interview, that I will link in the description, Femin states that he mainly takes inspiration from Proudhon, and he considers him a patriot and a sovereignist. And he considers contemporary anarchism as starting from Joseph de Jacques' libertarianism, not Proudhon's, since the latter was much more conservative in his work. Like, for example, Joseph rejected war, patriotism, having an army, sexual restraint, and male-female differentiation. To support this, he makes references to Proudhon's anti-Semitism, his extreme misogyny, and gives some takes from War and Peace, in which Proudhon rejects the abolition of slavery, slavery, and if he thinks that Caucasians are superior in terms of intelligence, morality, and the list goes on. He claims that his albums are a mix of anarchism and fascism in regard to lyrics and overall themes, and the songs that are about reality are also used as an attack on permanent surveillance, bureaucracy, centralized power, and anything that has to do with technocracy and the urban life. And that's about it. I hope I made it clear to you what anarcho-fascism is and what are the differences between it and other strains of anarchism. Don't forget that I also have other socials, link of those are in the description. And yeah, see you next time.